C3T or on the Twitter account C3Lingo. Thanks. He's going to say us where the journey will take that and what we can do with all our VRT 4050. Great applause. Thanks. It is on? Yeah. Hi. Good day. I'm Dr. An. I don't come from Mannheim, but from Darmstadt, but yeah, they won't stop us here. My topic is the future has two waves. A short overview, as well as looking in the past about Freifunk, which is a German free radio initiative, into hardware and how we can prepare for the future. The overview is I'll give a short introduction about, for all people who don't know Freifunk yet, and I'll tell you what Freifunk is about. Then I'll tell something about recommendations about hardware that communities should choose, and take a look onto hardware that's available and that we can use. After that, I'll talk about
deprecated devices.
How to govern with deprecated devices, old devices, because that's also an important issue here. And at the end, I'll give a short overview about what you can do as a community. Well, Freifunk is about decentralized mesh networks that are used in communities, in local communities in German, mostly in cities or small countrysides. Freifunk is both in politics and in technology engaged, and they were about the first people who used this in the large scale. But also, they're also involved in political processes like the German Störerhaftung law, which is about like liability if other people abuse the networks and so on. They are engaged in that as well. And they have a custom firmware, which is based on OpenWRT, which probably everyone has used already. I will start with some recommendations. Freifunk communities also often give recommendations for people. They say, hey, I want to join, I want to start. And often, Freifunk communities handle it that way, that there's like an entry device, a low-level device, but it's not well specified, and that's a big problem. What is entrance level and where does entrance level end? So what do you expect from an entrance level device? What do you want to like take a look and maybe take it down 1 month after? But is it something that you want to say where it's like, set it up and don't worry about it again, and you can let it run for months or something. Another issue that's often visible on websites as well is that people are just people that just inform themselves of websites are left in the dark because the websites are out of date, like 5 years or older, and there's only hardware that private customers can't buy anymore because they just exist anymore. And that's something that docks onto the entrance level devices. Why should we give an accommodation at all? And why is only VPN performance the only measurement on websites?
Genau.
So
jetzt mal die harten Fakten.
Let's talk about what was recommended. What we recommended until the last 2 or 1 years ago. It was often single-core devices by Qualcomm, which only used for regular NAT throughput of 100 megabits and or something, and relatively slow compared to PowerPC or ARM architectures. Most recommendations were 2.3 gigahertz single band, which has gotten a really large issue, especially in cities in the last year, because the 2.3 gigahertz band is full and you can't really use it anymore. And the issue arose that we were dependent on one primary hardware vendor, and that's not what we want, because we don't want to be dependent dependent on some company, and because they can always say, well, we don't do that anymore, and then we have a problem. So how do we should take recommendations? What are the differences that we should think about? And that's the most important thing is to inform the operator of the node, to inform him so that he can make an informed decision. What is the goal? What is his budget? And he can maybe think about that himself and maybe inform himself. And it's not just got told, hey, this thing does Freifunk, well, buy it. And he can make his own decision. But we have to pre-select compatible devices because the market is huge, and I can look at Wi-Fi devices for days. And we have to point out a few devices which are most compatible for our goals, and we help you to pick the right device from that list. And we also point out the differences between those differences. What does that mean? What's good? What's bad? And not just say, well, that's the device you should buy. Take it.
Also, node operators have questions, and it's important to be approachable and stay in contact. In best case, obviously, on a mailing list, some public way to contact you to answer questions and give information, which is very valuable. And so we saw what we used to recommend, and now we are looking at what we want to recommend. So we would like to have a fast CPU, and also because everyone is talking about it, but also because we want to say we also have some more load to put on it, so the person operating the node can also do some fun stuff with it and use it themselves without breaking down. Also, dual band Wi-Fi would be awesome, so 5 gigahertz would be nice, so because it's better for like modular operation and more bandwidth, and it breaks down less. Also, we want to give a choice in hardware vendors and not just say TP-Link is the one router we are using, and we don't want to be depending on this one vendor, and we don't want to be locked out from other vendors just because there was one decision made. Also, there's this revision bingo where we don't know which device will be released in the future, and that's never clear which device will be released in the future. And this is what I call the Freifunk effect, which is the price graph for one single router. And this is why we want to have a bigger choice in routers. This was on the market for 3 years, and as soon as it was used for Freifunk, or the price shot up and it was no longer available. And then we looked at what other options we have, what other routers are there, and there is two hardware platforms which we found very usable. We don't want to be dependent on one vendor, is one reason why we landed on these two. Some are implementing security measurements where we are not sure how this is going to be in the future. So we want to have open Wi-Fi chips, and we are using mesh, which a lot of routers can't do. So this is limiting down our choices. So our first choice, what we are most convinced by in the community, is Qualcomm IPQ40. Which has for C40 RRM, they have a lot of flash, they have 250 megabyte RAM, they have 2.4 and 5 gigahertz.
And das ist tatsächlich eine Besonderheit, daher kommt auch dieser Marketing Claim von 400 Megabit pro Sekunde.
So they have this special marketing claim for for a special gigahertz conversion rate, and also it has wave 2 in addition to that.
Als weiteren Wahl haben wir
and the second choice is or it's on the, it has been on the market for a bit now is one from MediaTek,
welche aber durch einen sehr aktiv entwickelten WLAN
punktet
und insbesondere auch
Wi-Fi operating device chip which is developed a lot and it
aber es ist eine exzellente Wahl für den Preis.
Ja.
Genau. Wir haben das Ganze ein bisschen geschaut.
We made some kind of observations and had a short look and what we liked best is that we could increase our wireless throughputs by 20% using these devices, using the same way to the client. This means at 80 megahertz channel width about 500 megabits per second, and the performance is really really noticeable. Like we have like double the data rates we could achieve. The expected cost was about 50 to 70 euro, depending on the model you choose, but sometimes the price goes a bit down. And we understood that it's like a very reasonable accommodation and a very reasonable choice for most operations and most goals. There's also some cheaper options because sometimes there's the issue that people don't want to spend that much money on a device, or maybe they can't. There's might have different reasons, and therefore we said, well, we need to have also a cheaper option. We need to find something cheaper to offer, and therefore we took a look, because 5 gigahertz is a thing we really want to have, and we don't take a compromise on that. And therefore we landed at a combination by MediaTek, which is about a single core MIPS processor with 24K executions, and no, it's just 128 megabytes of RAM, or maybe even just 64, and 16 to 32 megabytes of SPI flash. It's operating as well as 2.4 gigahertz, as well as 5 gigahertz, and the same as the MediaTek we talked about previously, was that it's supporting 802 but 0.11 AC on 5 gigahertz wave 1. The drawbacks is that we don't have any improvement in the CPU processing power against what we are using right now. Only thing is we have the 5 gigahertz band, which is like worth a lot. Another issue is that 64 megabytes of RAM is enough today, but yeah, we have to wait if we need to
in so eine 841 Situation.
If we come back into 841 situation, that in a few years the random access memory is not enough at those devices, because we have like 2 Wi-Fi radios. That means we have twice the queues on the device, and that's high cost for the RAM. And these are obviously drawbacks on these cheap devices. But yeah, you have to take a compromise there, I guess.
Die Geräte kosten 25.
Those devices are about 25 to 60 euros, depending on the model and the market price. But from time to time, it can be a better option, depending on the use case you want to achieve. For outdoor access points, there's not that much options, or maybe for ceiling mount access points. So if you want to do these things, you have to take another choice.
What's
important about accommodations, if a community decides, well, we need to rework our websites, we want to take a look what's up to date today, an issue is that you can't predict the future. We have seen in the past, in the very near past, there was a WR4100, and kernel size got too large, so bootloader could only load the first 3 megabytes, but it wasn't the whole kernel, so the device couldn't boot. So the bootloader size was too big, and yeah, it's not easy to predict all things in the forehand and to decide if it's like really sustainable or if you should choose another device. So it's also hard to set a time span at recommendations. We thought which time span we can tell all users that the recommendations are up to date, and we say, well, we expect this thing to work for the time span. That doesn't mean that after that day you can throw it away, but yeah, we can expect to look into the future that far. We have not the issues as the vendor, because the vendor often doesn't even do updates at all or doesn't update the kernel. The vendor doesn't even think about that, but we have to, so it isn't useful to say, well, that's a solution for forever or for the next 10 years, but you have to be realistic and say how far you can look into the future and how far you can predict the future right now.
Wir sind diesen ganzen Prozess durch.
We went this whole process in Darmstadt and thought about that and thought, how we can find the best, how can you help the node operator best to make an own informed decisions. And yeah, spreadsheets are very useful for that, so that's why we did it. We can see the table here that's visible on our website as well. And there's three categories: indoor, outdoor, and cheap. And
tun hierbei bei den Geräten
regarding the devices, we show all the specifications, what radios are, what is the CPU. So that node operator needs to inform himself what does it mean, what's good, what's not so good. And if he's not able to predict themselves on a technical point of view, we can give colorful highlights. So in this case, it's a tab for indoor recommendations, and at the cheap things, we can see it really good. We have it for outdoor. The choice isn't quite large here. We know that there's just one device, but we show what's really good about this device and what's not so good compared to other devices in that category. And regarding the cheap overview, you can see it really, really obviously that the really cheap options, there's very, very much highlighted, because we said, yeah, there's a device, the Netgear second device from the left-hand side. It is dual-band Wi-Fi, which is good, but the random access memory might be too small for two radios. So we take a decent look at the device and say what's the positive aspect and what's not.
Natürlich haben wir auch hierbei Installationsmethoden hervorgerufen.
We also highlighted the installation methods. I will come back to this later.
Genau. Okay,
so we saw what's available and what might be coming up in the future. And let's look back to the past and how we can arrange ourselves with that.
Und mit wir meine ich jetzt so alle.
Because we, and with we, I mean all the communities in Germany, that we saw that some recommendations are only short-lived, and that we can see with deprecated devices which only have 4 megabyte flash or 32 megabyte RAM, and like both of them are just insufficient. And for all communities, that's difficult to say how much longer we can go on with this if we want to keep up with the software and the technical developments in this area. And what we also need to look at in this area is that this is the baseline for a lot of communities, and it's not a solution to just like cut all of the hardware which is used right now, because some communities could just stop functioning if they can't use any of these hardware devices anymore. But some communities have started mailing to the people, pointing out, hey, we found some problems here and there are some alternatives. So let's see what we can do.
möchte ich jetzt kurz drüber rennen, weil
I just want to point this out very quickly, because on the 35C3 we had a talk on this, on the infrastructure orbit, so I recommend watching this talk. And so what we can do is optimizations through software, and in the talk there was a lot of more details on this. And a lot of communities are using Gluon, which is developed by a lot of communities in Germany, and a lot of the optimizations are already in there, so like there is no much more potential to optimize it further. A lot of the optimizations we can do are only very short-lived, because the technical development is just going so quickly, and so we need more memory, we need more space to save stuff on. Also, like, we can't just like do magic, so there are just certain limitations. I really recommend watching the talk on this from 35C3. Another point which has been talked about a lot recently, it's to soldier on more flash and RAM, which kind of fixes the hardware issues. So we do have more flash, we do have more RAM.
Muss man auch sehen, dass in upstream.
But we also have to see that for upstream projects, when you're using Gluon or OpenRT, as soon as you start soldering on your board, it's actually a new one. So it's a bit unclear what's going on there. There are revisions by the developers for a reason, so they are no longer patchable by the provider. And like Wi-Fi, we can't just soldier on a new chip. I know people have done it, but like I don't really want to talk about this. On the other side, you also, the node operators should be aware that there are consequences. You can't just change the bootloader, or like as soon as you like soldier on different chips and devices, it's unclear whether the next kernel update, this everything will still work on this device or on another device. So it's a little bit problematic to say this is the one solution which we should recommend and say, yes, this takes us, it works, because there is still a lot of risk that soon there might be some kernel update or whatever and it does no longer work actually. And at this point, it's important to give a realistic outlook what might be the consequences, and if people still want to do it, they are free to do it, but they have the knowledge to make this decision. So what do we do now? Well, the obvious choice would be to just buy new devices and everything will be perfect, which isn't wrong, but like it's possibly not the best solution, because like new devices are obviously cool when you look at the recommendations by the community, and then it's a big benefit if you make the right choice now. But on the other side, there might be problems. If I have used devices, which I have like soldered on my own stuff, and there is only LAN port now available, in some environments that might not be the perfect solution, because some people are soldering their own outdoor routers, and then your router might no longer fit in your lunchbox. So then you need to buy a new lunchbox too. And like obviously it can also be expensive. At GPN we pointed out like the whole cost for this, and if a community is running a lot of access points, then this cost might just be unbearable high. Another point which hasn't been looked at a lot by a lot of people is business or enterprise access points, which are no longer used by them. A lot of them have more than enough RAM and flash. A lot of the times they also have a really fast processor.
Die halt eben da
we have seen a lot of them which have specifically been used for this traffic cases we also use them for.
Change cycles here.
So the regular change cycles is 3 years. So even today, we already are finding 802 11AC gear, which is just very cheap or sometimes even for free. So that's an interesting option. What's also nice about this, a lot of these access points are already using OpenWRT. It's often not used for upstream, but a lot of vendors haven't used like other software, but a lot of them are actually using the OpenWRT, and you can actually add upstream without a lot of work. Some examples for this is enterprises which are just using ODM. So they are building firewalls, and we need Wi-Fi in our product, and they are just adding it by buying it on. And you have a lot of vendors, but they all are using the basic same board. So these are some vendors where we have seen this, which is, yeah,
genau,
where this is the case.
Wir sind tatsächlich auch schon fast am Ende.
And I'm already almost at the end of my talk. So I think a lot of people here are active in the Freifunk community and the local communities. What can you do? So we see the technological developments, and we are seeing what we did in the past, which might not always have been the optimal thing to do. What I think is important is that, like, because Freifunk is also about education, we should trust our node operators, not just give them ready-made solutions for everything, and there is not one-size-fits-all solution. But we think you are capable
dir selber eine Wahl zu treffen,
of making a good choice
etwas anspruchsvollere Installation
and do an installation which might be a bit more complicated, but we can help you out there. We have a good documentation. If we have any problems there, you can come to our meetings and you can learn something there. So this is what I think gets people interested in the Freifunk community. And this is something we also have seen a lot in our community, that when you are talking to the people and they are asking questions and they are coming to the meeting, they might come to another meeting. So we think there have been a lot of positive aspects from this. Yeah, just as I've said before, Freifunk is a long-term project. We have to develop ourselves. If I just think about my time for the past 4 years, the network has changed a lot from the technical aspects to the hardware. It's very different than it has been 4 years ago. So it's important to look at the use cases we have and that we have a broad spectrum covering all of the different use cases. So that's it for my part.
Yeah. Ja, herzlichen Dank.
Yeah, thanks a lot for this really interesting topic, Blocktron. There's microphones in the room, so if there are questions by the audience, just... Yeah, I see someone already over there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have a question about memory consumption, how to reduce memory consumption of OpenWRT. What are the components who put the most strain on it? The most load on memory, maybe in percentage, is by Wi-Fi, so by the radios. They have to operate two or maybe even three queues, and sometimes there's like private Wi-Fi or second mesh interface, and that's what consumes the most memory.
Okay, danke. Ist noch eine zweite Frage?
Thank you. Is there another question?
Hier vorne?
Yeah, in the front. I want to ask, because the choice of devices is small, what about blocked bootloader signatures and especially on the political layer, because I had a feeling that there was a big momentum there some time ago, but no, I haven't heard of anything trying to change that for a long time. There was those FCC story from a few years ago. Tendentially, the situation is that locked bootloaders and signed bootloaders are maybe more exception than the general. That what TP-Link did was like a new image format that they used in their CPI devices. In that case, locked bootloaders as such are not really common in the private market. Like, there are some vendors of access points that do bootloader lock-in, that the bootloader notices, well, you're trying to flash a modified software and the device does self-destructive saves. Secure boot isn't implemented and resetting now, and then the device is like toast, you can throw it away. But we haven't seen that on devices that we really used and really took in our hands and we really recommended. Sometimes vendors want to do that. Netgear has a device, AVM has a kind of signature verification in place, but it's not that an issue right now, yet.
Wait for the microphone, please.
Please wait for the microphone.
Also von Ubiquiti.
By Ubiquiti, there's often signature in place, and that's an issue. I only know the Unify devices by Ubiquiti, and they are quite open. You can't boot them via the bootloader. You can't flash it by the bootloader. But they load the image if it's in place.
Ja, noch eine Frage hier im Raum.
Another question.
Nein, das.
No, that doesn't seem so. Yeah, thanks and huge round of applause to BlogPorn and to the whole Freifunk community. And thanks from Translation Booth. You can give us feedback on Twitter on the hashtag.